Thanks. Thanks a lot, Sebastian, for the invitation, and thanks for to all of you for being present today at this online talk. So these talks want to be a review on the state of the art of lambda quantiles. So we all know about quantiles and the advantages of quantiles, but only a few are aware about this generalization that might be useful in some context. Lambda quantiles has been introduced in the mathematical finance context as a risk measures alternative to the usual quantiles. I will start with a review on the theory of lambda quantiles with its original definition as a lambda value at risk. Then I will briefly review the properties that have been studied so far that make it suitable as a risk measure. I will then focus on all possible alternative definitions that can be given of lambda quantiles, and in particular on a recent work where we axiomatize lambda quantiles in the non-increasing case. Then I will present a methodology to compute lambda quantiles, and I will focus on the first approach introduced to estimate the lambda function, that is the so-called benchmark approach. But also we will see a new approach that we have recently started and introduced, that is a more supervised learning based approach, is the lambda quantile regression. I will then present the backtesting framework for lambda quantiles and compare some results for the forecasting. I will conclude with some extension and work in progress on lambda quantiles and backtesting. So the idea of lambda quantiles is simple. Instead of considering a fixed level lambda, they are based on a variable function that we call big lambda. The one that I've reported here is the classical definition of quantile for a random variable. That means a quantile at level lambda of random variable is the smallest value such that the distribution function of the random variable is greater than lambda. Graphically, if the distribution is strictly increasing and continuous, the traditional quantile can be found as intersection between the distribution function and the constant line at level lambda. So you will find the traditional quantile. That one that I reported here on the left is the definition instead of a particular lambda quantile that is the right lambda quantile defined through the inf. As you see here, instead of considering a constant lambda, we consider a function lambda that depends on the x. As you see from the picture, under smooth condition on the lambda function, we have that the lambda quantile is given, is the value on the x-axis that corresponds to the intersection between the distribution function and the lambda function. So the idea is simple. The lambda quantile is simply a quantile whose confidence level has been established a priori having a particular desirable behavior that changes based on the value of the random variables. The motivation in risk management is pretty intuitive if we consider an increasing lambda function. Within this context, if you assume that X is the random variable of the profit and losses and F its distribution function, we aim to compute risk measures, and risk measure represents a capital requirement. So for many years, the traditional risk measure that has been computed is known as value at risk, just takes a quantile, a right quantile with a minus in front. So it appears natural to define a risk measure using lambda quantile in the same way. So the lambda value at risk, this is the name as is known in literature, is defined by minus lambda quantile. This is because we interpret risk measures as capital requirement. So in this context, it might be desirable to have a flexible confidence level that may establish a priori having an ideal behavior that we expect from this level. it may also natural consider that this confidence level increase with respect to the profit and loss, since this means increasing the capital requirement, for example, when we expect greater losses, as you see from the picture. Indeed, one of the classical complaints about the traditional risk measure, the value at risk, is the lack of a rapid adjustment of the confidence levels during changes in the economic cycle. Another positive point that we have with lambda quantiles is that we can set the lambda function in a particular way that we are able to discriminate the behavior between two distributions that have the same quantile at level lambda, but different behavior, as you see from the picture. For this reason, we say that the lambda quantiles may capture the tail risk. So this is also one of the reasons why the value at risk has been recently replaced by the so-called expected shortfall, that is an average of value at risk on the tails, in order to better capture the tail risk. So the original definition of lambda quantiles has been introduced in the risk management context in a paper with Frittelli, Maggis, and myself in 2014. That has been published in Mathematical Finance. Here, the definition of lambda value at risk uses the right lambda quantile that is defined in this way. In addition, in this framework, we had some condition on the lambda function, that is, that the lambda function should be bounded, monotone, and right continuous. We can say that the monotonicity is relevant in the theoretical framework, but also important for the interpretation. The right continuity instead was used in the context because here we have right quantile in the most general case of the lambda function, but it can be released in some case for decreasing lambda quantiles. Instead, the boundedness is necessary for having some property to hold, and also is key, especially the upper bound is key in the interpretation, since it represents the maximum of this lambda function as confidence level. So let's see just some example, a basic example to give you like an intuition how it works. And we consider a lambda as a step function. So the first case that we consider is the non-decreasing case. So we have a lambda that assume value 1% after x bar and before assume value 0.8%. Where here x bar might represent the highest loss we are expecting to lose with a probability of 1%. If we consider two assets, an asset A and an asset B, an asset A whose performance is better than the asset B, the lambda quantile will be equal to the traditional quantile for the asset A. Instead, it will be equal to the quantile at level 0.8% for the asset B. As you see in this case, we will put aside an higher capital requirement with respect to using a traditional quantile at 1%. So this is what we expect. So we have an asset whose performance is not ideal. And so we increase the capital requirement with respect to a quantile at 1%. So we can say that setting this increasing lambda function, we have a lambda quantile that is more sensitive than a traditional quantile 1% to left tail events. Instead, if we consider a non-increasing case, that's the case of having a lambda function that has this behavior, we will have that the lambda quantile for the asset A will be lower with respect to the quantile at 1%. So even here, the capital requirement will be higher. But in this case, what we can say is that the lambda function, the lambda quantile, is less sensitive with respect to a quantile at 1% to right tail events. So just to give any initial examples. So recently, in a paper with Bellini that is online on generalized quantile, we investigate into the definition of lambda value at risk a little bit more. And we introduce the concept of lambda quantiles. We first notice that in principle, the lambda quantiles can be four. There are four possible lambda quantiles. They can be defined through the inf or through the sup, and then we can have the left and the right continuous version. Notice that the lambda value at risk corresponds to minus, as it is a risk a capital requirement, the right quantile defined through the inf. So in principle, without any additional condition on the lambda function, we might have four different lambda quantiles. The aim of this generalization was understanding the properties of lambda quantiles share with the traditional quantiles. So that was the original intent. The general basic properties that we have are the following. Without addition of any condition on the lambda function, the lambda quantile satisfies only monotonicity and quasi-convexity or quasi-concavity with respect to distributions. We also have an additional condition, an additional properties that is the monotonicity with respect to the lambda function in a sort of symmetry with respect to the monotonicity with respect to the distribution function. In this paper, however, we focus more on the non-increasing case of lambda quantiles. That means considering lambda quantiles under the assumption that lambda is non-increasing. So under this condition, what we have? We have first that the quantiles, they reduce to two. So we don't have only four lambda quantiles, but only two lambda quantiles. We have, in addition, that under minimal assumptions on the lambda function, the lambda quantiles are finite, but also satisfy a normalization properties, that the one that I reported here. That means the functional defined on a delta on x is equal to just equal to x. In addition, we have another point that allows us in the non-increasing case to release the condition on the condition that lambda should be right continuous, since lambda can be either right continuous or left continuous, and the quantile will be the definition will hold. So the most interesting result of this paper is the axiomatization of lambda quantiles. The idea to axiomatize lambda quantile came up to our mind after reading a paper from Chambers, also this paper published in Mathematical Finance, where Chambers axiomatized quantile. Is not so well-known paper, but is very interesting. And the axiomatization of lambda quantiles is done using a properties that is the ordinal covariance property that is used in many applications of quantiles. Instead, here the property that we found that axiomatize lambda quantiles is the so-called locality property. This property is interesting since it's been described, it's just been described in the paper of Conker on the lambda, on the quantile regression. This is a paper where Conker, Conker wrote for the 40th anniversary of the quantile regression. And he prized quantile for being local and nearly impervious to small perturbation of distributional mass. What does it mean? This, it means that we can move the mass on the left and on the right of the quantile, and the quantiles remain unchanged. So this property is desirable since it expresses a very strong form of robustness with respect to outliers. However, we haven't found this property formalized, so we propose a definition of this property that says that if that it says that a function is local, if we define a function in an interval, we take a function in an interval, then the functional does not change if we alter the distribution outside the interval. So we come to the main result of this paper, that is that lambda quantiles in the non-increasing case are normalized functionals that are also monotonic and local. That is the main characterization. Then we have additional technical properties. These are weakly lower semi-continuous and weakly upper semi-continuous to identify the left or the right quantile. So let's move. So this is a theoretical results that we have investigated in the non-increasing case, but still the increasing case is still open, the axiomatization. Now let's move to some properties that are interesting in the application. The first property that we have studied, and this is I studied in the past with other co-authors, Burzoni and Ruffo, we decided to study some properties that are relevant in the financial application, and we started with robustness. The reason why robustness is relevant is pretty clear, since we want that risk estimator is not so sensitive to small changes in the data set. The definition of robustness that we use is the classical one, so the definition proposed by Hampel and Huber in the 80s, that is equivalent to the continuity with respect to the Levy metric. We use a result of Kant of 2010, where he gives a sufficient condition for an historical estimator of a risk measure for being robust. That is that the risk measure is continuous with respect to the Levy metric. So we found that the historical estimator of the lambda value at risk, so minus the right quantile, is robust under some condition, which are this condition: we need to have a lambda function that is continuous and does not coincide with f on any interval. So from these results, we start to think that the lambda function, we need to construct a lambda function that is based on the set of distribution function which we want to apply to the lambda quantile to have good results. Another property that we studied, and is important in the application, is the convex level set property. Why is important? So this is a property, is the necessary condition for the elicitability, and the elicitability is the important property for backtesting and for the applicability of the supervised learning methods. For backtesting, the reason why elicitability is important for backtesting, and we can the reason that I share is that we can use elicitability and the loss function implied by the elicitability condition to construct a backtesting based on this loss function. And then the applicability of the supervised learning methods is given just the definition of elicitability. So what does it mean, a convex level set? We have a convex level set if a functional, on two distribution assume the same value gamma, then the functional of the linear convex combination of this distribution has the same value gamma. So this is the convex level set property that is satisfied by lambda quantiles in a non-increasing case. So this is a good news. But regarding instead the non-decreasing case, the situation depends on the case. It's more complex. So the non-decreasing case, it might be more interesting from more intuitive, but it's more difficult to treat from a theoretical point of view. The results that we had is a result with my co-author Burzoni and Ruffo, where we have that we need a particular condition on the lambda function for having the convex level set properties. We need the lambda is non-decreasing and piecewise constant, so basically is a step function. And we need that the set of distributions on which the lambda quantile is applied is increasing. So these are these about the convex level set property. Now let's come into the elicitability condition, that is the fundamental property for backtesting. First of all, for some of elicitability has been praised and discussed a lot in the quantitative finance context. For some of you who doesn't know what the meaning of elicitability, a functional, a statistical function is said to be elicitable if there exists a scoring function, positive scoring function, such that the function can be written as minimizer of an expected loss. And this loss, the interpretation of this loss that helps to understanding its applicability in practice is that the loss represents the magnitude of the forecasting error between the ex-ante prediction and the ex-post realization. So you see that the loss function can be used in a backtesting context to compute the backtesting error, but also in for supervised machine learning methods that now are gaining much attention, not only in the industry, but also in academia, since they are based on the minimization of a loss function. So regarding this elicitability, we have the first results has been given by Bellini and Bignozzi in 2015. They found that lambda value at risk in the decreasing case is elicitable. They use a stronger definition of elicitability, but they found this scoring function that is still valid. We extended this result in 2017 to all the lambda quantiles also in the increasing case, and we have that elicitability holds under this condition on the distribution function. That we know we can also see this condition as a condition on the way we should construct the lambda function. So we need that essentially that the distribution function overpass only once the lambda at the lambda level, lambda value at risk level. In addition, we need that the lambda function is bounded. So this an additional remark that we need to construct a lambda function based on the distribution function which we want to apply the lambda value at risk. So let's see just an example. This is a basic example of a two-step non-increasing function, the one that I presented at the beginning. Just to say that we can easily compute the scoring function that we see here when the lambda is simple, like in this case. And if you look at the scoring function, in this case, we have the first two specifications correspond to the scoring function of usual quantiles. We use this scoring function in the application of our framework, of the framework that we are going to test later. So before concluding with the theory on lambda quantiles, I will present the lambda quantile regression framework. Indeed, thanks to the elicitability property, we are able to define this framework in the same spirit of Conker and Bassett of the 1978 paper. We are at this, this is a working paper, not yet online, and we are studying this framework from a theoretical point of view and also application. So this is just, these are preliminary results. But the framework parallel the one of quantiles. In fact, if we assume that lambda quantiles depends linearly on some covariates and some parameters, the lambda quantile forecast can be given through these parameters estimated minimizing the sum of the loss between the observations and the linear prediction, where the loss is the same, is the loss for that particular lambda quantile that we are using. So the loss that we have seen before in the general case. So now I'm going to present some method for the computation of lambda quantiles. So now we have seen the theoretical framework. Okay, first of all, we need to build the lambda function. So we need to construct this function lambda. And this step, we need to decide first the lambda direction, how we want the lambda. We want the lambda decreasing, increasing. One option could be based the construction. Of course, this application is in a risk management context. One option, the option that we propose, it is to construct the lambda function based on market trend. We might consider an increasing lambda function when we have a bearish market trend, or decreasing lambda function when we have a bullish market trend. Another things to consider to decide are the range of values. So we need to establish what is the minimum of the lambda function and the maximum. Especially the minimum of the lambda function is a critical choice. In the paper, we have given some proposal, but actually a study on the minimum of the lambda function has never been done because actually this minimum value of the lambda function represents the lowest confidence level at the maximum loss that you can have. So it's a critical choice. Then the maximum of the lambda function instead represents the maximum of this confidence level and is the best choice. We use 1% paralleling the choice that has been done by the regulators for value at risk. We have also tried to increase this confidence level. We can increase the confidence level up to 1.5%, still having good result, but actually this depends on the risk aversion. The functional shape, the functional shape also depends on the risk aversion profile. It can be linear, it can be convex or concave based on the fact that the institution is more or less adverse to the risk. So these are, after that you have decided all these steps, finally, how can we estimate the parameters of the lambda? So we propose a method to estimate the parameters of the lambda that we are going to show in a while. So this step, this first step, the construction of the lambda function is common to all the approaches to computing lambda quantiles. Then you might use a simulation approach or a parametric approach or a supervised learning approach. A simulation approach, it means simply doing the same that you do for a traditional elliptic risk. That means building the distribution function with Monte Carlo simulation or historical simulation. That means simply simulating identically independent and identically distributed random variables and then building empirical distribution function, and after apply the formula using the inf. This is a while algorithm to compute the lambda quantile. If we don't use a simulation approach, we can use a parametric approach, and this when a closed formula is available. And I'm going to show in a case where we found a closed formula for lambda quantiles. Supervised learning approach is we start with lambda quantile regression. What does it mean, supervised learning approach? It means to predict the lambda quantiles based on data, based on covariates, assuming a certain behavior of the lambda quantiles with respect to these covariates. They can be linear or whatever. This approach, we are just at the beginning of studying this methodology. I'm going to show now the case where we have where we can use a parametric approach is, for example, for step function lambda. We have this in the non-increasing case, but also in the increasing case of lambda, non-decreasing case. And you see that you can compute the lambda quantile in a pretty simple way, and the lambda quantile depends on the if we have two-step lambda, depends on the quantiles at the level, at the levels of the lambda, but also depends on this parameter t bar, that is the threshold where the lambda function change level. That is an important choice and must be taken. Okay, now that we have seen how to compute the lambda quantile, so we know the methodology to compute, to forecast the lambda quantile, as any time in a risk management application, you need to propose a backtesting framework. And so we investigate also the backtesting, what does mean backtesting, and how backtesting is conducted. And what we have with another co-author, Corbetta, we have a framework for backtesting lambda value at risk, so lambda quantiles, that parallel the framework of value at risk. The important things to say here is that violation are Bernoulli. So, and this is common to the value at risk framework. However, violation are not identically distributed, since here the parameters of the violation change at any time, because you recompute the risk measure, let's assume you compute the risk measure daily, okay? So you will have daily a different parameter, a different confidence level or level of coverage, how you wanna call it. And so these are violations that are not identically distributed. We assume that these violations are independent. And this is not that strong assumptions in this case, since the quantile, the lambda quantile is computed based on the past information, so incorporates already the recent past information. So we have seen that we don't have like so a cluster of violations, but actually additional tests can be done also in this direction. So once we have understood how the violations behave, which test we can apply? So we have a set of violation over backtesting windows, let's say it's 250 days of risk measure estimates. So what we do, we sum up all the violations. So we sum up Bernoulli, that are independent but not identically distributed. Here, luckily, probability theory helps. because there is a result, there is this, actually, not many people knows this this distribution, but it's very important in this framework, is the Poisson binomial. So the sum of Bernoulli that are independent but not identically distributed follows Poisson binomial. So we have a theoretical, a straightforward results that comes from a probability theory. So we don't need to do any simulations, any asymptotic test. In the paper, we propose additional test, but actually this is the test that we believe that is the most straightforward, is the one that parallel the traffic-like approach for a value at risk. Notice that you need to, the tricky points here is to understand the null and the alternative hypothesis. We accept, so not reject, the model if the relative frequency of the exceptions is lower than the confidence level. Of course, we can compute this relative frequency of the exceptions only at the end of the after 250 observations, another important thing to observe is that the binomial Poisson distribution needs a vector of parameters. So only after 250 observations, you can compute the test statistic. So this is the framework that we are going to use in the applications. So now let's go to the first example of real estimation of the lambda function that we proposed in 2018. The idea is to, so we need to estimate the parameters of the lambda function. We assume the simplest lambda function. We assume a linear lambda function that we want to obtain by linear interpolation, okay? The main assumption that we do is that this lambda function represents a distribution of the market, a proxy distribution. So we need some market benchmarks in a way to estimate these distributions. So we select some market benchmarks and we want to, so that we need this market benchmark to compute some order statistics that will help us to position the lambda function on the tails because we want that this lambda function then represents a confidence level, so should be positioned on the tails. So we select this benchmark that in the equities work could be Standard & Poor's, PUTS-MIP, PUTS-100. And we compute the minimum return, the maximum value at risk, and the average value at risk, and the minimum value at risk of the benchmark. Then we take an equipartition of the level on the probability asset, and we fix some points. So of course, more fancy applications can be done, but that was just to understand how we can, you know, how can we can handle this object. And what we do, so we recalibrate the lambda function with the same holding period of the distribution of the risk measure. So you will compute the lambda value at risk daily, as well you will recalibrate the lambda function daily. In this way, we have that we can capture the recent market trend and also the specific asset reaction to the market trend. As you see from this example, let's assume that you have at time one this lambda function, and this is the distribution function at time one. If the day after the market gets worse, and so the lambda function shifts on the left, If the assets responds in the same way of the market, so we shift on the left, then you will put aside more capital with respect to a traditional quantile 1%. Instead, if the assets react in an opposite way with respect to the market, actually we will, in this framework, we'll put aside the same of a traditional value at risk at 1%. We have tested this approach in two papers, and we have taken a sample of equities that were severely affected by the financial crisis, and we and so this and I decided to report it here, this graph, because it shows the, from my point of view, the most interesting results, that is the reactivities of the lambda value at risk that is much higher with respect to the other risk measures. Okay, you see this box shape behavior just because here I've reported the historical simulation approach. But you see that the lambda value at risk, okay, the one in black are the auto-sample returns, and the blue line is the lambda value at risk at 1%, the red line is the value at risk at 1%, the dashed line instead is expected shortfall at 2.5%. That is the one that is proposed by the regulator at the moment. And you see that we have peak of loss, and there is an immediate reaction of the lambda value at risk much faster than the other risk measure. But this is just to say, it's just to say, having a flexible confidence level might work. Then, of course, we need to adjust the risk measure in a way that much more capital is released during good periods, because, yes, the, we want actually to improve into this estimation in a way that also we are able to release capital when there are good conditions. Well, no, this is the idea that having a confidence level that is flexible in my work. We backtest in the approach, and this this graph shows all the, and this table shows our results. We have tested the historical approach, GASH and GARCH, we did students innovation and extreme value theory with generalized Pareto. What we notice is that, okay, we improve with respect to a traditional value at risk, and the approach that seems to perform better is the GARCH with the students innovation, as expected, also for value at risk as a good performance. And but also the historical simulation is not that bad. Historical simulation is basically having an empirical distribution function on which you apply the risk measure. Finally, we test the lambda quantile regression, that is at preliminary stage. What we wanted to test here is not the estimation of the lambda function. So we are not really interested in the fact that the lambda function should capture the trend of the market. What we want to test is this method to predict lambda quantiles. And we want to compare with a traditional classical approach as an AR1 GARCH model with TD students innovation. So we want, this is a classical statistical parametrical approach used also for value at risk. So to see if we can have comparable results. And what we got is actually something that for us was surprising. So in this picture, you see in orange the lambda quantile regression, so the prediction of the lambda quantile using the lambda quantile regression. And the, in blue, you see the prediction of the lambda quantile using R1 approach. What we are predicting here, we are predicting the log return of the Standard & Poor's with a rolling windows of 250 days using R1 and GARCH11 model. Instead, with the how we are using the lambda, so the covariates that we are using in the lambda quantile regressions are the lagged log return of the Standard & Poor's and the lagged log return of the VIX index. So you see two approaches that are very different. One, the statistical approach that is based on a series of 250 data, so it incorporates informations that comes from 250 data before. Instead, the lambda quantile regression that just is based on the value of the vix, that is an external variable, and the lagged value of the variable you are predicting, but we get comparable results. And this is also confirmed by the backtesting results. We use the same framework of the Poisson binomial, and we get comparable results in terms of p-value. And it was quite surprising for us. So we are still investigating into this framework. Regarding the work in progress and the future research, we want to improve into the estimation of the lambda function. So what we want is possibly adding a value to the definition of the lambda value at risk in a way to detect the change in the market condition, so the lambda function can automatically switching from increasing to decreasing based on the market condition. And something that we're doing in collaboration with Silvana and my PhD student Akif Ince is the risk contribution and sensitivity analysis on lambda quantiles. And then we want, of course, to continue working this on this lambda quantile regression, in particular on the theoretical properties, and also exploring application more deeply in this statistical learning framework as lambda quantile regression 3, forest, and others. But something else that I'm doing, hope to do soon, is to extend the backtesting framework of the lambda value at risk to other risk measures. Because what I've noticed is that you can use this approach of computing the level of coverage for all the risk measures. So you consider a risk measures as a quantile, any risk measure you consider as a quantile on or a capital requirement on an x-axis, you can go back on the distribution function and actually getting a coverage level that is what we expect that risk measure should cover based on the assumption that you have done on the distribution. But yeah, this is lots of stuff to do, hopefully COVID allowing to work soon on this. These are the paper on which the talk is based, and yeah, thank you for your attention.
Great, thank you. Thanks very much, Ilaria, for whirlwind tour of lambda quantiles. So we do have time for some questions. So if you have some questions, please feel free to type them into the chat, and I'll call upon you if you'd like to ask them live, or I can read them out as well. So just to give people a moment or two to write in questions. Maybe I'll kick them. Oh, okay. Actually, we've got one coming up there. So Simon, would you like to turn on your mic and ask yourself? Oh, you have no mic. Okay, I see. So so this is a question from Simon Cliff. He says, does it make sense to define lambda? I presume that means lambda expected shortfall, lambda ES. Is lambda value at risk a valid objective for convex optimization? Question mark.
Okay. I've got the question. So it doesn't have...
Okay. Does it make sense to define some notion of lambda expected shortfall?
All right. Yes, it does. It does. Yeah, another thing to add to the list. Yes, it does. It does. Because in my opinion, I so the expected shortfall say it's an average of quantiles beyond the value at risk level, we can do the same with this. Actually, but all the time we go into, but we have an additional complication, you know, this lambda function, but the definition, it can be given. Yes. Then the issue is how you compute it, but yeah, it can be given.
Okay. Interesting. Okay, that would be interesting to think about. And there's a second part to that question, kind of disconnected, but it's a second question there. It says, is lambda value at risk a valid objective for convex optimization?
Okay. The fact is that convex optimization, we have additional parameters here. If we want to use, typically use optimization in a portfolio management context, okay? And if you have an additional parameters, things get complicated. I don't think this is the best framework to use the lambda value at risk. But I haven't investigated actually deeply in this. I don't think it's the best direction to go now, since we have many additional parameters to estimate, to understand. So you will add these parameters to the problem, and it will be interesting to see, but I haven't investigated.
Okay. So again, if you have questions, please feel free to type them in and I'll call upon you. Let me ask something about robustness. So I think you mentioned a particular theoretical result that said that lambda quantile is somehow robust to probability mass moving left or right of the
locality, yes.
Right, this locality property.
And so, we have the robustness and locality, yes.
So I'm wondering, what about, is there some notion of robustness on the choice of the lambda function itself?
Mm.
So the data is fixed, but you know, you've constructed these, you have these different approaches for kind of constructing lambda functions.
That's very interesting.
But if I perturb it in some way or another, would my estimate of this this quantile?
That's very interesting, because actually this is very, because you see there is this sort of this symmetry, you know, between lambda and the distribution function. So everything that you can ask, you know, what is the behavior of your statistical functional based on like. Based on the distribution function, everything that you can ask yourself refer to the distribution function, you can ask also refer to the lambda function, and then see the combination of the two aspects. So yes, I think this is interesting to investigate the sort of robustness with respect to the lambda function. It's a new framework to set up and see. That can be inherited by the framework that we have for a distribution function. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. And maybe I don't see. Is there anyone else with questions coming in? Tom, I see you there. Okay. I was also wondering, is there any connection between lambda quantiles and distortion risk measures, or are they very? Is there a choice of a distortion weight function that makes it equivalent to a lambda quantile, or are they not at all related?
I try to find this connection. I haven't found it.
Okay.
I haven't found it.
Because it seems tantalizingly like how it should, right? But, or it feels like there might be, but I guess.
There might. It's a quite complex object, very flexible, and there are interesting stuff. Yeah, I haven't found it, but actually I tried. Yeah.
Maybe I'll ask one more then.
There's a lot to do on this.
Of course.
And everything is complicated.
Mm-hmm. So you know, you had this plot where you were showing comparing the AR1 Garch or the Garch versus the Lambda quantiles, and
yes,
you were showing how they kind of are similar. But one thing I noticed.
Yes.
Here. Yeah. This one, right? Slide 22, right? One thing that maybe I don't know if this is typical or characteristic, but if you look at the big spike just before 450 in the AR Garch, it comes down really quickly and then sort of stays near zero, but the Lambda quantile more plateaus, if you
exactly.
will. It doesn't come down as quickly. And that sort of characteristic persists in different places. If I look at, say, 1650.
Yes, this is what we have noticed.
You see these spikes then come down in the Garch model, but the Lambda
quantile seems less variable. Yes, yeah. It might depend on the fact that the R1, the Garch model is estimated using more information.
Mm.
That's an idea, a possible explanation.
So you think instead, it reverts back more quickly because of that extra information is telling it to come down?
Yes, okay. I think so. But actually, this is something that we have noticed. And also we have noticed, but what was surprising for us is just the fact that the results are comparable, even if they have different approaches.
Absolutely.
So, and this is interesting to investigate a little bit more. And
There's another question coming in from Noah. I'm going to pronounce the name poorly, sorry. Noah Blonia, and says that, can you throw more light on the elicibility property of the Lambda quantile or Lambda
can
bar?
Can you
explain a bit more about the elicibility property?
Elicitability property.
Yeah. And he said that's doesn't quite, just if you can explain it a bit more. And then there's another question from Andres.
Okay. Okay, let's this is the elicitability. Okay, the elicitability property is defined in this way. So you have a functional, so you need to, so a functional is elicitable if there exists a scoring function that is strictly consistent. And this is the scoring function that you need, and it can be written so as minimizer of the expected score. We have found this. We have this scoring function that has this shape. Actually, if you look in some of my papers, I have a formula of this scoring function that really parallel the one of quantiles. So basically, this is the scoring function. The first specification here, it's the scoring function of a quantile at level lambda 2. And the scoring function of lambda quantiles parallel this behavior, where instead of having a constant lambda, you have an integral over two values, basically. That's the fact. So, and then the elicitability, is the property that allows you to write the estimator as minimizer of some forecasting error. Okay, if you want to think in terms of application of a sum of forecasting error, the listability allows you to see your estimator as the minimizer of a series of a sum of forecasting error, if you want to.
So it gives you this sort of supervised learning interpretation.
Exactly. It's the elicitability property that gives you the supervised learning interpretation that is fundamental for the modern application.
Okay, so we're just after six, but there is another question, and I think we might as well take it and then call it an evening. So Andreas Mora, would you like to ask the question yourself?
Thank you very much. So yeah, it seems in slide number 19, I think when you showed the backtesting, it seems
slide 19.
Yes.
19. Mm-hmm. Thank you. It seems that 1%, I think, is the blue line, lambda var overestimate risk compared to 1% of var and 2.5% of expected shortfall. Is it usual for other, other returns? And if it is, which kind of level would be recommended for capital regulation for lambda var? Thank you.
That's the key question. So is to find the recommended level. And this is an issue that the regulators also have for deciding what is the recommended level for the expected shortfall. The choice of the regulators has been 2.5%, but why? And in literature, there are not many studies actually on what should be the good level. So there are not so many studies on the confidence level that we should choose for a risk measure. And so we have done some tests and see that you minimize the violation having a maximum the lambda function that is 1%. At maximum, you can get it, you can take it at 1.5%, and still is good, but not moving too far. Because if you move too far, you increase the number of violations, and so nobody's happy. But the fact is that how many violation we want to have, and what we want to backtest. I mean, this is another question, but how many violations we want to have, that can be like, if we know how many violation maximum we can tolerate, we can maybe going back and think about, okay, this is could be the level of confidence, or this could be the variation of the level of confidence. It's not, understanding how the lambda function should behave, it would be understanding how a confidence level also should behave, increasing, decreasing, because if you decrease the confidence level, you put aside more capital, maybe it's too much. If you increase it, you put aside less capital. Maybe
violations, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's the point.
We have a difficult regulatory issue, right? Deciding on what's better for society overall. And so
exactly.
Okay.